Hello and welcome to Showcase, TRT World's flagship arts and culture program. Today we'll introduce you to a brand new affordable art event in Istanbul as we question how affordable art really is. But first, so we pop for hey! We'll wave our hands in the air as we take a look at the evolution of what has become more than just a style of music. During the 1970s in New York, there was an underground sound climbing its way onto the streets. This new style of music was called hip-hop. It came with its own set of attitudes, clothes and mentality. And it began being performed and listened to by mostly African Americans. This new form of lyrical expression was soon universally embraced. So now, 40 years on, we look back at the birth of hip-hop and how it's evolved over the years.
The cultural impact hip-hop has had on mainstream culture is evidenced by the crowds who recently flocked to this pop-up museum in Washington, D.C.
I need your hand right there!
But none of them would be here if it wasn't for these guys. The Sugar Hill Gang. Their song, Rapper's Delight, may not be the first song to feature rapping, but it certainly was the one that launched a new era in music.
You see, I am Wonder Mike and I like to say hello.
In the beginning, hip-hop ushered in the era of the MC, singers who spoke more than sang, commanding microphones in a way never done before, as well as DJs who expertly controlling turntables, scratching records in sync with the vocal beats of the MCs.
It makes me wonder how I keep from going under.
Everybody was either a DJ or B-boy, and I was a B-boy. But we started rapping because, you know, the rap part, that was what everybody wasn't doing.
When you say you love me, it doesn't matter, it goes into my head as just chit-chatter.
By the late 80s, the predominantly male scene saw the rise of female artists who used the rhythm and poetry of rap to tell their own stories. While on the surface, hip-hop songs were about bringing people together and having a good time, but if you listen closely, there was a B-side to the music. Lyrics about social injustice, poverty, and racism blended with lyrics about big cars, big guns, and big bucks. Brother, you
wait. 7-Eleven, 7 even back door, little jump.
The song still touched on daily life, crime, and potentially discrimination.
Nobody I know got killed in South Central LA. Today was a
But some lyrical gangsters also told stories about the high life.
I don't exaggerate at all, man. The more money you make, the more problems you get.
They showed that being a hip-hop star means more money and more problems. And one of those problems was the deadly rivalries between recording artists for the hip-hop throne and the gang violence associated with it. And it was a battle that musical enemies Tupac Shakur and Biggie Smalls paid for with their lives. Some believe their deaths marked a change in hip-hop culture, with it moving away from violence back to what it was about 40 years ago.
Cops give a damn about a Negro. Pull a trigger, kill him, he's a hero. Get it back to the kids who the hell cares.
Hip-hop culture now is more subculture, it's more drug culture, it's violent culture. You know, the culture of violence, that has nothing to do with hip-hop. You know what I mean? Obviously, you know, we did get high, but that's not what hip-hop was about. Hip-hop is a music-driven culture. It's not a violence-driven culture. It's not a drug-driven culture.
I was gonna get up and find the broom, but then I got high.
Talking of drugs, another subgenre had also been emerging since the start, known as comedy hip-hop.
Because I got high, because I got high, because I got high.
Shady's back.
Often layered with satirical lyrics and music videos, they were almost like parodies of other songs and people. But they still managed to top the charts, showcasing hip-hop's diverse sides and global appeal.
It was forced upon society as a whole to let it happen. They couldn't stop it. You can't stop what can't be stopped. You can't kill what can't be killed. And that's hip-hop. God's plan.
I hold back, sometimes I won't. And to this day, it is a force to be reckoned with. Hip-hop has still stayed true to its roots, and it is still used to tell stories and experiences over a beat.
Hip-hop has come a long way since its first days in South Bronx. One journalist documented the role of photographers in all those years, carrying hip-hop's visual culture to the global stage in her book Contact High, A Visual History of Hip-Hop, which is being turned into an exhibition opening this April in Los Angeles. The journalist behind this project, Vicky Tobak, joins us now. Hi, Vicky. Welcome to Showcase.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Why do you think it is important to document the local neighborhoods and communities that gave birth to hip-hop?
When hip-hop was a local phenomenon in neighborhoods and communities, it was really something that came, that was for the neighborhood. It was really something that came out of, you know, a certain political, oppression. It came out of young kids that really wanted to, you know, express themselves. And so when you look back, it really was all this newness. It was really all this making something out of very little or nothing. And that also, you know, came out in the photographs. I mean, when you look at young, Kool Herc, or when you look at the photographs of Jamel Shabazz, in neighborhoods, you see this newness, this rawness, you know, and the photographers, they felt in their gut that was important to document. And, all these years later, there is this great archive that exists that really tells the visual story of what hip-hop came to be.
Mm-hmm. So let's hear Rapper's Delight by Sugar Hill Gang now.
Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet. You see, I am Wonder Mike, and I like to say hello. Up to the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, and the purple, and yellow. But first, I gotta bang, bang, the boogie to the boogie. Say up, jump the boogie to the bang, bang, boogie, let's rock.
So this song is accepted by many to be the first song to introduce mainstream to hip-hop sound, right?
It's considered, you know, a song that really introduced the mainstream to the hip-hop sound. But, you know, if you dig a little deeper, you know, that song was actually heavy influenced by Kaz from the Cold Crush Brothers, which was an early group from the South Bronx. And, you know, what Sugar Hill Gang did was sort of tap into what was happening in the underground in the South Bronx, and took a lot of that style and made it palpable for a mainstream audience. So, you know, there's sort of like a mixed history on that record. Certainly it was, it did its job in, you know, getting the word out to the masses and getting people interested in hip hop. But really it was something that was already happening, with Afrika Bambaataa, with so many, young kids in the Bronx that were doing this every day.
Mm-hmm. And how about the 80s? What was happening in hip-hop scene back then?
I mean, much of the 80s and into the 90s, when hip-hop started to come from, you know, the communities and neighborhoods and being a local music, all of a sudden it started getting attention, you know, from magazines, from the media. You started to see movies getting made about hip-hop. And, you know, that transition from music that came from communities and neighborhoods into an industry and a multi-billion-dollar industry that we see today, that transition sort of happened, you know, in the late 80s, early 90s. A lot of record labels were formed, focused on hip hop. A lot of big names started to come up. You know, you started to see the beginnings of, you know, Jay-Z, Biggie, Nas, Tupac, you know, artists that then became global superstars, you know, out of the neighborhoods in onto a global stage.
And now let's watch a short clip and then I'm back with a question.
Lyrical douches in your bushes who rock grooves and make moves with all the mommies. The back of the club, sipping my wet is where you find me. The back of the club, macking holes, my crew's behind me. Mad question asking, passing, music blasting. But I just can't quit because one of these honeys Biggie got to creep with, sleep with, keep the epa secret. Why not? Why blow up my spot? Cause we both got hot. Now check it, I got more Mac than Craig and in the bed. Believe me, sweetie, I got enough.
So what is the importance of Biggie's Big Poppa video? I mean, tell me about it.
So this, you know, the Big Poppa video, and I was actually there for the filming of that video. I used to work in a nightclub called Nell's in New York, which was like a really important club for the hip hop world. And, you know, they, Hype Williams, the director of Big Poppa and Biggie and Diddy, Puffy, they, you know, they chose Nell's because it sort of symbolized this moment in hip hop. Really, you know, starting to make money and really starting to become, you know, a financial empire, if you will. And it was this moment in the 90s where a lot of, you know, hip hop entrepreneurs, a lot of artists started to realize their power, started to realize like, oh, I'm influencing kids all over the world. We are selling a lot of records. We are influencing style, fashion, and, you know, and a lot of entrepreneurs embrace that. And so you start to see that, you know, in the videos, like Big Poppa, this sort of flossing element, this this element of sort of embracing commercialism a little bit more, which, you know, some people in hip hop kind of look askance at. But, you know, but it was also this moment that influences what we're seeing now, you know, this great power, political power and influence and financial power that hip hop has gained over the years. And, you know, with the Biggie, Big Poppa, you kind of see the beginnings of that.
Started off on an island, AK Shallon, brothers wailing, gunshots thrown and phone dialing. Back in the days, I'm eight now, making a tape now. Ray gotta get a plate now. Ignorant and mad young, wanted to be the one till I got blah, blah, blah. Yeah, my pops was a fiend since 16, shooting that dash in his bloodstream. That's the life of a crimey, real life crimey, and others know the habits behind me. Day one, yo, growing all up in the ghetto, now I'm a whip. Jet the palm metal in Medina, yo, no doubt the guard got crazy clout pushing him from now south.
And we just saw Wu-Tang Clan's Can It Be All So Simple. I mean, it marks a really important moment, doesn't it?
You know, Wu-Tang is, they were really different when they came out. You know, their sound was really grimy. It was really different. It was almost, you know, maybe in reaction to a lot of this kind of like flossing, very shiny, flashy kind of hip hop that we were starting to see with the, you know, Bad Boy Family. And, you know, Wu-Tang, they changed up the industry across the board. I mean, they were nine dudes in a group with this really underground, unapologetic, raw sound. They also had their individual record label, record deals happening, which was really unusual for the industry at the time. And, you know, in that video, in that song, you see a real underground style. I mean, you see who they were, you know, these guys from Staten Island and Brooklyn, just kind of wearing what you would see regular guys in the neighborhoods of New York wearing at that time. And sort of that regularness coming out into, you know, that claiming that power that Wu-Tang did was really revolutionary, you know, and that sound just changed up hip hop going forward after that.
And now let's move closer to today with Kendrick Lamar's Element.
Going digital and physical and all y'all, ay. Bunch of criminals and money in my phone calls, ay. We okay, we let the A1 fly. Relocate, jump on the same G5. Check it for me heavy, cause I go, yeah, I go, yeah. They never been ready, yeah, I know, yeah, I know, yeah. 100K spread across the floor, yeah. None of y'all fucking with the flow, yeah. Years in the making, they don't y'all mistake it. I got them by a landslide, we talk about races. You know this never be a tie, just look at they laces. You know careers take off, just gotta be patient. Mr. 1 through 5, that's the only logic. Fake my death, go to Cuba, that's.
What characterizes the 2000s in hip-hop visually, you think?
Yeah, so, you know, nowadays you see artists, you know, we're post-genre in hip-hop. You know, hip-hop went from New York and it went all over the world. Artists like Kendrick Lamar, you know, they're using visuals in a really smart way. If you look at the Element video, a lot of photographs from Gordon Parks, which, you know, he was a legendary photographer from the 60s and 70s, and this Renaissance man who also directed the film Shaft. Kendrick Lamar, you know, tapped into some of these visuals that Gordon Parks had for the Element video and updated them for the hip hop generation. So it's sort of this communication and visual style, excuse me, of, you know, hip hop recognizing its past, recognizing all these legends, all these, you know, amazing style moments that it had, and really claiming that for today's, you know, for today's kids and for today's listeners all around the world. So, you know, Kendrick Lamar, he won a Pulitzer Prize last year. Nowadays, hip hop is really being recognized as a voice, you know, a voice of young people all around the world. And so seeing, you know, a video like Kendrick Lamar and looking back at, you know, where it started in the 70s is really a powerful moment.
Well, thank you so much for joining us on Showcase, Vicky.
Thank you.
Coming up later on Showcase, stepping through a world of art along the Bosphorus. Istanbul takes the stage as the city's hottest contemporary art event gets ready to launch. But before we bring you those stories, here are a few others that made it onto Showcase's radar. Four-time Academy Award winner Alejandro González Iñárritu has been chosen as the president of the Cannes Film Festival jury. The director will head the official selection competition at the 72nd edition of the festival and becomes the first Mexican director to hold the position. Oprah Winfrey and American arts patron Agnes Gunt have signed on as honorary co-chairs of a charity auction at Sotheby's, a first of its kind taking place at a major auction house. Buy Women for Tomorrow's Women will benefit Miss Porter's School, an all-girl private high school in Farmington, Connecticut. Modern and contemporary works by more than 25 female artists, including Carmen Herrera's abstract painting, will be sold as the centerpiece of Sotheby's contemporary curated auction on March the 1st. A city situated at the meeting point of Europe and Asia. In the past years, Istanbul has secured its position on the contemporary art map, and it's here to stay. The latest addition to its art scene is STEP Istanbul, an event that hopes to make art an accessible phenomenon. For 4 days, STEP Istanbul aims to gather collectors, artists and galleries with the idea that art should be a part of everyone's life. It's a collaboration between one of the city's leading art fairs, Contemporary Istanbul, and TomTom Designhood, a project that brings design and art together. The event is a new platform for local and international art enthusiasts to gain and share personal experiences. The first edition of STEP Istanbul kicks off on the 25th of April. And now let's find out a bit more about Step Istanbul and talk to the creators of the event, Ali Güreli and Hakan Kodal, who join me now in our studio. Hi, and welcome to Showcase.
Hi.
Sounds like a great project, Step Istanbul. Very exciting. And your message is reflecting art as an accessible phenomenon. And I wonder where the idea came from, because we see more and more accessible art events around the world recently, right? I mean,
well, I guess it started maybe more than 10 years ago on the world, mainly in New York and certain cities in Europe. But now we're starting in Istanbul. But it depends on a need, actually, mm-hmm. in the market. And depending on the statistics that we followed in Contemporary Istanbul Art Fair last year, we realized that 64% of the participants, visitors, are below the age 35. So there's a big young crowd, big young population, which is really interested with art. Mm-hmm. And not naturally, their budgets are not as much as flexible as we were looking for. And they want to learn more, they want to know more, they want to become more knowledgeable. So STEP is our joint idea to another step to educate mainly, and then also so that these young people maybe will be able to purchase art.
Mm-hmm. So and is it fair to say that there is increased demand towards
exactly.
affordable art?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Affordable art. There's a demand for all kind of art, actually, not mm-hmm. only affordable. The contemporary art world is really enlarging and growing and developing in Turkey, especially among the young people, as I said. Mm-hmm. So if we can make them purchase their first artwork, let's say, in their life during the STEP times, then they will continue, I believe. So it's not only the collectors, actually, also the artists, which will be joining this STEP event, they will be maybe selling their first artwork during the event. So it's a step for everybody.
Mm-hmm. And that makes me think, actually, how important, Hakan, how important do you think these kind of events are for emerging markets? After all, in emerging markets, you have more emerging artists or emerging collectors than established ones. So what do you think about that?
Of course, I mean, it's related to the purchase power, first of all, in emerging markets. So there is a limited number of collectors having really certain wealth to be able to buy artwork. So mm-hmm. To be able to enlarge this market, especially in emerging markets with the purchase power, and especially with young population countries like Turkey, mm-hmm. It's important to be able to touch a larger population, younger population, to be able to educate them, and especially to make them new collectors. And also give, let's say, chances to new artists. It's very important.
Hakan, this whole event is focusing on one neighborhood. I mean, it's getting its inspiration from one neighborhood, TomTom in Istanbul. For people who might not know, what makes this neighborhood so special for you?
TomTom is in the old part of the town, especially between Karaköy and İstiklal, which is which is historically where the trade and where the art events were taking place. So that district is transforming for the last four or five years, and this is the new and upcoming design district of Istanbul. There has been many events in the past, mm-hmm. especially on design events. There has been some other events on other topics, but there are already a lot of art galleries in this neighborhood. There are a lot of designers, young artists already established in that neighborhood. So which means the art is already there. The idea came up with first when we were doing a design event in TomTom design event, which takes place in October. Usually for the last 3 years, we see more and more people coming to the street, because it's not like in the big fairs where this art fairs are, you know, it's not connected to the street. That was the idea, to make this event a step to the art, which means it's easy to step in because it's on the street. So which means the neighborhood is transformed into a neighborhood of art. Mm-hmm. And there will be art galleries, there will be, of course, exhibitions, there will be different ateliers, and, you know, so we'll incentivize people to get in, mm-hmm. And to touch this. It's not something to be afraid, you know, it's not in a big hotel or in a big building, it's on the street in various buildings. And in the same street, there are Italian consulate, Italian lycée, a French palace and Venetian palace, and etc. So the aim is to be able to make this event into more international to start with. Of course, to be expanding in different buildings. So people will come, will be on the street, but at the same time visiting buildings, mm-hmm. and there will be surprises. It's not a just art event, but it's at the same time a social event. So there mm-hmm. will be a lot of venues, there will be, you know, parties inside. Because it's not
Sounds
just
like
art, it's
Step Istanbul
being part of the
potential to transform yeah. the neighborhood even more. I'd
exactly.
say. Thank you so much for joining us on Showcase today, and good luck with Step Istanbul.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. And if you're looking for more of Showcase's coverage of the global art scene, you can find it on our YouTube channel. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. See you next time.